Good morning, saints.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. You're looking especially festive this morning. Lots of people in red, got a few Christmas sweaters going. Woohoo! Yeah, happy third Sunday of Advent. How is it with your souls this fine day?
Well.
It is well. I just have a few announcements that I want to share this morning. First, don't forget your prayer cards. Carol will pick them up after the first reading. And thank you. This is what Carol told me to say. Thank you. I would have done it anyway. For all the help you gave with the Warrior Giving, we filled out all of our families. And this afternoon, everything will be taken over to the church to get sorted and ready for families to pick them up later in the week. So thank you for your generosity in all of that. This afternoon will be, at 2 o'clock, will be the service for Marcelina Colorado, mother of Reverend Bernie and Reverend Moody, who are pastors in our conference. Bernie is pastor at the Lindgrove Church, and that's where the service will be held today. Marcelina was also the grandmother of Neil and his whole family, and of course, his all of his cousins and everything, but we want to keep them in prayer. She was the matriarch, and she passed in peace and lived a faithful life, but just keep them in your prayers, and we'll pray for them later, too. Carol wanted me to remind you, sign the attendance pads. And any other questions, any other announcements, things that you want to share that are happening?
Aaron.
Yes, sir.
Dave. All right, one more time, I reminded you last week, please, as your heart leads you, as your led by the Spirit, please give something to feel so for our staff, for everybody to keep things coming here at the church. And everybody who wants to be behind the scenes, it just makes everything so much better for all of us.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. There's something right outside there. That you
Thank you, Dave. And just so you know, too, this is a great church to serve. Your staff knows that you support them, and that means the world. So thank you for that, too. Anything else? Okay, today is Communion Sunday, so we also have offering plates up here to put offering in, just to let you know that. All right, friends, we're going to sing a lot today. I'm very excited. So, would you stand for the Carol of Praise? We're going to sing Hail to the Lord's Anointed, verses 1, 2, and 3.
Messenger calls, prepare the way of the Holy One, make a pathway for God.
Blessed be our God, who brings light out of darkness.
The prophet proclaims, make way in the desert for the coming of God.
Blessed be our God, who comes to grant us peace.
Are you ready for the coming day of God?
Let us worship the one who calls us into light.
please join me for the mission and vision statement.
We have gathered here to know God personally, love Jesus passionately, and to have our lives filled with purpose through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We are Norwalk United Methodist Church, and we are doing the walk.
Yes, we sing the first hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Justice for the poor and peace for the afflicted. Let your herald's voice pierce our hearts and announce the dawn of your kingdom. Before the advent of the one who baptizes with the fire of your Holy Spirit, let our complacency give way to conversion, oppression to justice, and conflict to acceptance of one another. We ask this through the one whose coming is certain, whose day draws near. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We have the scripture reading, Isaiah 12, verse 2 through 6. You may be seated. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid, for the Lord God is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the nations, proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Jesus. We light this candle as a sign of Christ our joy. May the joyful promise of your presence, O God, make us rejoice in our hope of salvation. Please join me in the response, O come, Emmanuel.
Captive's from
Scripture reading, Zephaniah 3, verse 14 through 20. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all of your oppressors at that time, and I will save the lame and gather the outcast. And I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you home, at the time when I gather you, for I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord. Now we have special music by the choir.
Beautiful. Our gospel reading today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 3, verse 7. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor,' for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." And the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" In reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers also asked him, "And what should we do?" He said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threat or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages." As the people were filled with expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." So with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. Would you pray with me? Beloved Lord, we pause for a moment and breathe deeply of your presence. Help us to set aside for this time, this hour, all the things on the to-do list in the back of our minds, and help you to be able to speak to us. As we meditate today, help us hear once more your good news, and help us open our hearts to receive you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the people came out to see John, who was exhorting them with good news. "You brood of vipers." Prophets, Zephaniah, John, both doing their thing, both doing what God had called them to do. So to think a little bit about what it is God wanted them to do, what their task was as prophets, we turn to a great cultural event, the annual September Hawkeyes Cyclones football game. Pick a football game, anyone, but or any game for that matter, but this one helps us kind of get into the feel for what is happening here. Because you know what happens, right? From the minute the training starts with the teams, well, even before then, by the time the season ends, right, speculation begins. Who will be in what positions? What recruits will there be? What will those recruits do? Will any of them be in the starting lineup? Who will be the quarterbacks? What will the coach do? Pick a coach, either coach. And how will this player, who had trouble with interceptions last year, overcome that burden? And how will this part of the team that once in a while fumbled the ball too many times at the last minute, and, well, you know what happens sometimes then. So how will that be overcome? It starts like that sort of in May, doesn't it? And it escalates all the way to the game in September. And in the meantime, all of the spectators, either on TV, online, in person, begin to make their plans. Who are they going with? Are the tickets in place? Where are they going to stop on the way to, on the way from, to make sure they get there in plenty of time, get a parking space, can get in? And the conversation happens among everybody else. What's going to happen in this game, right? Who's going to win? We want to win, right? Pick a side, right? Everybody does. Who wants to win? Who's going to win? What's going to happen with this team? What's going to happen with the game? So by the time we get to the start, anticipation and energy is already off the charts. And the energy of the crowd fuels the work of the team on the field, and the game begins. The team, for its part, tries to pay only as much attention to that as is actually helpful, if they're good. Hard to ignore. But they are doing their preparation too, right? They are practicing, they're doing their maneuvers, they're studying game tapes. Checking to see the strengths and the weaknesses of the other players. And they're also listening a bit to the coaches, particularly to the talk about the other team, right? Have I missed anything? Right? But now we get a feel for what John and Zephaniah are doing in the true prophetic tradition, right? Using language of the end is near and destruction and judgment, they are whipping up the crowd in preparation for God's action. Okay. For some generations, oops, there are liquids behind me. For some generations, fear is a motivator, and certainly even for us, we think about how we account for ourselves before God, and we think, how will we do that? How will we know that we've been faithful? And we think about our accountability to God and to other people around us, in our faith community, for how we have lived our lives. Perfectly appropriate, right? But there's also a huge element of how do we open ourselves to what God is doing here, this new thing. Because the whip up of the crowd and the anticipation is an invitation to the people to get themselves ready, to do what's necessary to open their hearts, their minds, their spirits to whatever God is preparing for them. Now, Zephaniah spoke in a time when there was a rare opportunity. After David was no longer king, Israel and Solomon too, Israel went through a long period of time where there was fracturing of the faith community, and they broke into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, and there were battles between kings of the north and kings of the south, and threats from without. But at the time Zephaniah is preaching, we have about a 30-year window of opportunity before the exile happens to Babylon, where Assyria has fallen as a mighty power. Assyria had been the greatest threat to Israel at that point, around its borders, a huge military might. But when Nineveh fell, it opened up the possibility that renewal could happen for the people of Israel. And Josiah became king, and he was a reformer. He wanted to call the people back into a greater relationship with God and a greater faithfulness. And it is in this time that Zephaniah speaks these words to the people of his nation to say, this is the moment of opportunity that we have to turn ourselves around and be the kind of people that God wants us to be. Look at the possibility. There are threats around us. We still have people who want to do battle with us, but our biggest threat is within. And it's not the kind of stuff you might think would be a threat. He does talk about fraud and other kinds of things that we would call criminal or immoral, but he specifically speaks to complacency, to say, people, you're not paying attention. Who are you as God's people? How are you going to live a faithful life? Because if you're not paying attention, when the world crashes, you will crash with it, whatever that looks like. John is doing the same thing. He doesn't know yet who the anointed one is going to be, right? But he says to the people, this is a time for you to get ready because we know God has something new in the works. Someone is coming. And this one is going to be so great that I'm not even good enough to be his slave, because only slaves tied sandals for people. He whips them up, and actually, they welcome it. Right? Tell us what we need to do. And he speaks very clearly to two things that were critical in his time, critical before him, critical in our time. He says to new officers who they weren't technically tax collectors, you know, like Zacchaeus. He wasn't technically a tax collector, although that's what he's called in the Bible. The Roman government employed tax collectors, and they went around and they collected taxes from people, but they were paid by the Roman government. The kind of tax collector Zacchaeus was, he was an independent contractor, and it was their job to pay all the taxes themselves from the region where they were supposed to collect, and then go out and get it, which you might guess would have been a process fraught with opportunities for corruption. And in fact, it was, right? Because when Zacchaeus is challenged by Jesus, is converted by his presence and his message, he says, I'm going to pay back double what I took from people. He confesses to having stolen. And he says to them, collect no more than you are supposed to. Right? Have integrity in your work. Don't put fear into people because they don't know how you're going to shake them down. Ditto with soldiers. Now, the soldiers of the Roman government were paid pretty well, and generally they were pretty well controlled. But they also, the Roman government, hired militias and mercenaries who were not so well overseen and were not so well controlled and perhaps were not so well paid, not sure about that. But the soldiers, the mercenaries, also had the reputation, well deserved, of shaking down people, raping women, burning properties, just doing what they did because they could, right? And he says to them, John says, if you want to go a straighter path, if you want to be ready, then what you do is do your job with integrity. Don't shake people down. Don't hurt people that you're supposed to be here to protect. And to the rest of the crowd who asked, he says, share what you have with others. If you have more than one basic garment, then give the other one to someone who does not have one. Make sure that you are generous to people who are in need in your community. Pay attention to who's hungry and feed them. Pay attention to who's discouraged and help them. Pay attention. Show the compassion and care of God. All of this to pave the way for God initiating a new thing in the world. The job of the prophet is to call forth for us the places where we are not paying attention to God's presence in our lives and not doing our part to let God transform us. To look at the things that block us from greater faithfulness and openness to God's Spirit at work in the world. There are all kinds of things. And to turn from that, which is really repentance, right? Repentance does sometimes come with being sorry for things. But repentance is a turning away from and turning toward, right? So at this time, 2 whole weeks before Christmas, we're invited to ask ourselves, what is it that we need to turn from so that we can turn toward the newness that God wants to bring to us? And it's always a process, right? It's not always a one-time thing. The turning happens throughout our lives. But what's going on now is what we're invited to think about. How about, where are the hurts that get in the way of healing and greater openness? Is there something there to turn away from? The fears. Are there fears that we carry with us that keep us from engaging with the world or challenging ourselves? Because sometimes the fear is within us. It's not about anybody else. It's ours to own and address. Are there places where we could be more generous with ourselves, our time, our treasure? Are there things going on in our communities that we read about or hear about on the news, but it's in one ear, so to speak, and it out the other? But where perhaps, if a little time and prayer and attention were paid, there might be in that an opportunity to respond to a call from God to do something more. Is there old stuff we just need to let go of? Easier said than done, of course. But all of this is to help us see in the tender care of God that it is possible for us to turn away from the things that block us from giving ourselves to God's work wholeheartedly and living with wholeheartedness through our whole lives in everything we do. But what's needed for that process to start is our consent. And so the pre-game hype, so to speak, to push us out of our complacency and our comfort and our routines and the places where that becomes rigidity and stubbornness, or something else, so that when the advent of God's new thing arrives, we are able to see it And the door is always open, but this time of year, it is particularly so, is it not? Because we see the pains and the hurts of the world and our own in a different light, if you will, a more vivid light than sometimes at other times of the year. And yet, well, yet it's not the right word, but sometimes it seems, I'll speak for myself, that paying that kind of attention can be overwhelming, yes? Because where do you start once you start seeing all the need of yourself, those around you, wherever? But John and Zephaniah remind us that facing into this is possible with the help of God. Zephaniah says, don't let your hands grow weak. So we're invited here today and every day to latch on to the promise of God, that if we heed the prophet's call and listen to how God is at work in ourselves and in our communities and in our world, God's new world will come. God's work will begin again, over and over and over again. My friends, Jesus has come, and he is here, and he is coming. And because of this, we can heed the prophet's call and step into the new life every single day that God offers us. Amen. As we prepare to pray, we'll start by singing What Child Is This, the first verse. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for your presence is the source of our life. Your sustenance fuels us to face the blessings and the challenges of every day, and for this we give you thanks and praise. We offer our prayers this day for the needs that are known to us. We particularly pray this morning for the people of Kentucky and Tennessee and Arkansas and Illinois that had communities and deaths affected by and deaths from tornadoes over these last few days. We ask you to help them to help one another, and to take courage in the face of their losses so that they can recover and start life anew. We pray for our healthcare workers as cases of COVID rise and hospitalizations rise and our deaths rise. We ask that you give them special strength for this period of time, coming 2 years, after 2 years of hard labor. Hold them up, grant them your peace. We give you thanks this day for the life of Bob Dole, for his service to our country, both in battle and also in his service as a legislator, a lifelong servant of the people. We pray for his family and friends in this time of loss, and we thank you for all that he did for our country. We pray this morning for the Colorado family on the death of Marcelina. We praise you for her life. We ask you to hold her family in your peace and in your care. We pray this day for Danica, a 5-year-old who had surgery and is hospitalized and now has pneumonia. We pray for her healing, for your anointing spirit, for strength for her family and all of her caregivers. We ask, O God, that you help us to recognize the places where we have not let you in, where we've not let you help us, or where it's just hard and we may not even have the strength to do that. And we just ask that you hold us in your tender mercy, so that with whatever strength we have in our hands, we can serve you and see with our eyes the new world you're opening up to us and take those steps into the new life that you want to bring to all of us every day. We offer these prayers and praises in the name of Jesus, your Son, the one who has come, is here, and is yet to come, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's sing. I invite you now to turn your hymnals to pages 15 and 16. Where the responses are printed. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, Lord, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts, and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink it, remember me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here on these gifts. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with in ministry to all the world, until he returns in final victory and we feast at his table forever. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
The cup over which we give
thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. This is Christ's table. He is the host. He is the food. Everyone who wishes to come and be renewed by this table is welcome.
Thank you.
Friends, let's share in the body of Christ together. Blood of Christ. Let us pray. Generous God, the bounty of your love overflows into every aspect of our lives. In Jesus Christ, you have given us your greatest gift, the great sign of your steadfast love. May the gifts we bring before you this day be a sign of our commitment to share your love with those in need. We pray that you will use us, the works of our hands, the offerings we place on your table, and the ministries of your church to bring your healing and hope to the world. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I invite you to stand. Our closing song is Good Christian Friends Rejoice, number 224, if you've got your hymnal open. Our dismissal and blessing today comes from Philippians. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, with thanksgiving and supplication, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your lives and your minds in Christ Jesus. My friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Go in peace. Go in peace.